That was easy. Matt Travis is the developer and author of the book, and has been a catalyst in Ithaca, New York, having been part of this long-term project of revitalizing an urban renewal core in downtown, a small city in upstate New York, to what it is today. It's an unusual and exciting, inspirational accomplishment that Mac and his team have worked on over the years. And with him also is a very, very bright and hardworking downtown executive, Gary Ferguson, who has done some amazing things. And what I noticed from Gary's work is that he'll develop ideas and concepts that seem kind of impossible to do, but then they get done. And it's really an impressive story of his work with Mac and many others in City Hall in Ithaca to see what we see today. Now, again, we're not trying to focus on Ithaca and cities that size. We're trying to make this transferable to other places in the country that are much larger and smaller as well. So we have a nice array of people online today. And that'll be good. Gary's been the executive of the BID since 1999. And fundamentally changed downtown, more than doubling the size of square feet, now over 1 million square feet of space in downtown Ithaca, a city of 30,000 people. Let me just not waste any more time. I want to get into the special people that are here today. With us today are our two presenters, Gary and Mac. Again, Gary has been the executive director of the Downtown Ithaca Business Improvement District since 1999. He comes from work in Ohio. I think he's originally from Maine, but he went to work and did some great work in Grand Junction, Colorado, and Dayton, Ohio. And now he's with us and continuing to make great progress on topics. Through his energy, vision, and his hard work, getting things done type work, he has played a major role in inspiring the city of Ithaca to reshape itself. Now, Matt Travis is the author of this book called Shaping a City. It came out about a year and a half, 2 years ago. And I'm finding it to be just a really useful book to kind of look at economic development through stories and through situations and real people and real community and real issues. And it's full of those types of experiences that you could learn economic development from through storytelling. And it's an enjoyable read, even if you're not from Ithaca or know Ithaca very well. He has the vision of renewal of Ithaca and took some risks. But most importantly, he's been a catalyst in helping people see the potential of this downtown area. The potential measured in terms of housing units, getting the right information to support his decisions. So he was one of the first to actually invest in downtown housing and housing throughout the Ithaca community. That's both quality and affordable. So it's an exciting person to talk to because he has a community ethic as well as a real estate practical background. So I'm gonna stop here and welcome our two first speakers, Gary Ferguson and Mac Travis. Thank you guys.
Thank you, Bill. Let me go to the next slide here. This is our book, Shaping a City. And I've often laughingly said that Gary's the brains behind this town. I'm one of the players on his chessboard. But what this is about really is not just the downtown. The book is about 45 years of community building in Ithaca. Bill was in Ithaca, we met, and he invited Gary and me to do a series of lectures last May. We had 3 one-hour lectures. And when he had this idea, we condensed everything down to less than an hour. So what you're going to see today are some of the major projects that we've done just within our BID district. It's a small portion of our entire town, but this thought and really energy of growth has taken hold in Ithaca. It began back in the 70s with planning by the city planning people, the mayor, the Cornell, and it has just grown. I entered the picture in 73, bought a single family house, and have since grown and grown and developed quality housing as a strategy and have over 1 million square feet of retail, office, and apartments. So this book is really about your town as well. It's the role of city planning. For us, it was collaboration with Cornell and TC3, our and Ithaca College, our three major educational groups, the establishment of a BID, a business improvement district. And that more than anything else, at least in my mind, has shaped Ithaca. The major drivers Gary educated us in for a town are arts, dining, and entertainment. And that leads to density. The tools, strategic plans, zoning changes, tax abatements. And our results have been over 20 new projects. We've doubled the size of just our downtown. And we've had over $500 million of investment since 2000. And right now we have another actually $250,000 of investment underway just within the 22 blocks of the downtown. And it's probably three or four times that when you extend out to Cornell and the west side of town and so forth. So this is our natural feature. We have three major gorges that run through downtown. Beautiful, tranquil city, very natural settings. We have an emerald necklace that has been built around downtown with donations of hundreds and hundreds of acres of land. That's Cornell, the university that sits on East Hill and looks out over Cayuga Lake, our 40-mile-long lake in upstate New York. It's part of the barge canal system. You can actually go from Ithaca to Manhattan and across the world. So there are 25,000 students at Cornell. When my father went there in 1940, graduated, there were about 8,000. When I moved to town in 73, there were 16,000. And the university said, we're not growing. This is all we'll ever have. And today they're at 25,000. So you can see that there's a big growth there. Urban renewal was enacted in 1949 and had a tremendous impact on towns across the country. We took our main street and turned it into a pedestrian mall in 74. The idea being, from a planning standpoint and convincing the merchants and the property owners and the politicians, that a mall in downtown would help us compete with the malls that were being built in the surrounding area, sort of sucking the vitality out of downtown. This is the Ithaca Hotel, and this is the vacant lot when they tore it down. It sat vacant for 15 years, trash, just a mess. And the city began construction with a HUD grant and a private developer in 1980. And this was a good example of public-private partnership and the local banks coming on board with FMHA loan guarantee. We built, or they built in that time, Center Ithaca, 144,000 square feet, public atrium where today we have events. And it's been a successful building after it went bankrupt. We bought it in 94 and turned it into something. This is Gary's domain, downtown Ithaca. It's about five blocks across. And this is Green Street comes in and then it loops out as Seneca Street. So one way in and out of town. And Gary, if you could talk about what this map is and how we came to this, and how you came to it. I think that would be worthwhile for us all to hear.
Thanks, Mac. And thanks everybody for joining us today. We created a business improvement district in Ithaca in 1997. We, meaning the community, I came in 1999. But it's a 22 block district. At one time, actually in the mid 1990s and early 1990s, there was an effort actually to create this bid even earlier in a geography that was probably twice or even triple that size. That did not go so well. And in fact, to the point where they put it on hold and decided to retool it and come back with something that was a little more precise, a little more concise, a little more devoted to the traditional downtown core, which is these 22 blocks of downtown. And that became our business improvement district. As you can see, it kind of some of the boundaries are fairly obvious because they follow a watershed, or they follow a water course, or they follow a road. Others are a little more convoluted in an effort to try to make it so it would work to the best benefit of all the people at the time. So, but it, I know when I came, it had a budget of about $134 million, the bid did. I wish $134,000. And today our budget's about $1.2 million. So it's actually grown substantially over time as we've taken on more work and become more involved in a lot of the aspects of downtown life.
This center road is where Center Ithaca, the old Ithaca Hotel, the vacant lot was. And Gary, when he came to town, interviewed just about every business. I think there were 400 members of our business improvement district in that 22 block area. He certainly interviewed the major ones. He came back to our board, and we had a board of 15 members or so at that time with City Hall, the planners, and the retail and tenants. It was a good mixture and property owners. So he came and said, there's a major architecture firm of 180 employees in one of the buildings right on the commons that wants to move or expand. And they can't decide if downtown is going up or down, because we had a 20% vacancy at the time. And they had 9 offices around the country. They could go wherever they wanted. So Gary came to our board and he said, what we need is a strategic plan. We need to figure out what we want as a community. And he invited Ken Danter from Columbus, Ohio. He had been in Dayton for many years, and Ken did research and feasibility studies. And this is what Ken came back with. We could do 50,000 square feet of new retail space, 150,000 square feet of new office space, have 1,500 new jobs, about 500 housing units. We could rehabilitate our 1,600 seat state theater. We could build a convention center, a hotel, a new parking garage, and really improve the perception of Ithaca as the safest and friendliest commercial district. I called Gary and I said, Gary, this guy's got to be nuts. How can he say that we can build, 500 units of housing in downtown Ithaca? That was my business. I knew it. There wasn't a market for that. So he said, well, why don't you call him? So I called Ken and he said, we've done 1,500 of these feasibility studies. We look at the absorption rate. We look at the vacancy rate. We look at the employment numbers and the overall economy. And extrapolating from the other communities we've looked at, this is what you can do. He said it was 80 to 100 units a year for 4 to 5 years and $100 million. Well, our jaws dropped, but we did it. And Gary, you want to explain what this was a study you had done, or someone in the bid did, and what does this show us?
This was at our first strategic plan. We do 10-year strategic plans. We're actually finishing up our third one now. So we like to look out forward. We're doing strategic plans not for the bid. We're doing strategic plans for our downtown. And the idea is to figure out what's the game plan, what's the vision we want to all aspire to, you know, 10 years down the road. And so in this first plan, one of the things we wanted to impress upon people was that at that time, back in the year 2000, there was, you know, the suburban growth was rampant, and it was pretty hard to get a lot of developers or folks to consider doing something downtown or in the urban core, if you will. And so one of the things we were trying to was to explain was that the amount of space required to do the same amount of development was in that, and that's what this particular graph and chart shows you, from a rural standpoint to a downtown urban location, which is that green dot, that the amount of land and space you needed to put that same amount of growth and development was just dramatically different. Hence the notion that even back in the year 2000, downtown development was a very green, a very sustainable, and from a community policy standpoint, a very smart idea. So the idea was, I think, not to make sure that our policymakers understood that, but also that begin to let the community understand that it made a whole lot of sense to try to bring development back downtown.
And this drop, 68 units would take 121 acres out in the country, 1 acre downtown. Huge difference. So this is an interesting slide. This is a poured-in-place concrete warehouse built in 1924 on a site with several service stations. And as I jokingly say, I started believing my own hype, or the hype of the bid. And went and spoke with the owner. He was 80 years old. He said, you know, I've assembled all this and I had hoped to develop it, but I will sell it to you. And my wife and I purchased 4 acres downtown with this old warehouse and the converted service stations. He, bless his heart, held paper on just about all of that. And it transformed into this building here. This turned into this with 16 new tenants downtown. It was taking what the bid and Gary had put together as a vision and making it a reality. And we then built Ithaca's first luxury apartment building. The president of the bank lives in there. 26 units were built right next to downtown along 6 Mile Creek. It's actually at the very edge of the main business district. This was the warehouse. These are the new apartment buildings. And what happened was phenomenal. It was contagious. And the book goes into great detail about the personalities and the motivations. And this slideshow is much condensed and not in order, but Gary, you could talk about the fight we had. Well, it was a fight with the planners and the neighbors on this pink building over here.
Well, sure. I mean, hats off to Mac and his wife for taking the plunge into trying to develop in downtown. It took a local developer to do that. And once they started their work, others took a look. And so that pink building literally across the street from the parcels that Mac bought was an old industrial building that had been converted into a nonprofit. That nonprofit wanted to move. And so that was actually available as a development site. Now, unfortunately, or fortunately, that parcel backed right up onto East Hill, the East Hill Residential Historic District, which is where a lot of Cornell professors and faculty and staff from Cornell live. The idea of building a large project next to that neighborhood all of a sudden generated a ton of blowback. And there is a lot of discussion about how to how best to deal with that. A lot of people spent a lot of time compromising and coming up with some great ways to cut the building back to make it so that it would provide a little more light shed. But we were able to get through all that and ended up with this Seneca Way project, 32 units of, again, high-end luxury housing and some office space at one of the key gateway entrances into downtown. And it really helped define the eastern entrance of our downtown in a way that never before was the case.
Here is Gateway. Here's the new Seneca Way. This is the loop around downtown. Just a block away from this building, one of the hotels that we had hoped to see was built. The ground floor was, or the first on that site was a one-story building that was a travel agency. And the fellow who owned it was the son of a Greek immigrant who'd made a lot of money washing dishes, starting his own stores, and really supported his son who wanted to build a hotel there. They tried to put together a deal for just a hotel and could not really raise the money, convince the city, convince the banks that this was a project. So the mayor got involved, Gary got involved, the president of Cornell got involved, and they came up with a plan. Our city planner, Tate Van Court, was very involved in this too. This project became a site for 350 or so employees of Cornell's development office. It spurred the construction of a parking garage, and the four stories above it became a hotel, Hilton Garden Inn. And again, development we found was contagious. The bid's vision had really taken off. Next to it, our local bank, the largest bank from 1845, Tompkins Trust Company, built their office building and consolidated 350 employees in this new project, literally next door to the Hilton Garden Inn. Gary, you want to talk about what happened here and what it meant to downtown and the walkability as a force?
Yeah, I think that this slide particularly shows some redevelopment that happened on part of our pedestrian mall that we call Bank Alley. When that trust company project took place and they moved to a different location, all those buildings you see there on the left were vacated. And there was a real worry, quite frankly, that some developer would come and tear them all down and we'd put something, a high rise there. So there was a real effort not to have that happen because these were obviously very tastefully done and reflected the historical character of our community. So this was a great undertaking where we had an interested owner, the bank, who wanted to see something really done with these that would benefit the community. But we had a nonprofit in town, which actually was run by the county. It was our county historical society. It was kind of called the History Center of Tompkins County. They actually got together and got a consortium of other nonprofits. By the time where they were done, there must have been 10 of them, and all who had interest in having a downtown presence. And then maybe being part of a museum of history and culture, and what was the result was the buildings were actually purchased by our county, by Tompkins County, and essentially leased to this consortium of nonprofits, who now occupy it, and this is now the home of our downtown visitor center. It's the home of the Tompkins County, the Tompkins History Center, which is now, and the whole complex is called the Center for History and Culture, and it's a it is our it is a downtown museum. It is obviously it's on the pedestrian mall, so it's eminently walkable. It has some great exhibits. It's free to the public, and it's you know, it's become one of our visitor destinations, which has obviously been one of the key things that we at the BID have been trying to do, is come up with different ways and different attractions that would motivate people to come to downtown or remain in downtown for longer periods of time.
Very good. Another hotel, city public-private cooperation. Developer bought this 8,500 square foot site, postage stamp, and was able to put a hotel above it because the city agreed to allow him to cantilever over the parking garage and use a great chunk of that parking garage for his hotel. It took 5 years to put together, but again, very successful and part of the strategic plan. Things went so well that we did the 2010 to, well, the 2020 strategic plan. 92 pages, Gary, you wrote by talking to people. The community met. That was one thing, huge communication and meetings between the BID board, Gary, City Hall, and we'd fill the library meeting space talking about what do we want, what do we want to see. And here you see it. We want more national retailers, down another downtown, more housing, office building, more housing. We want to bring 1,500 new residents. We want to update the commons. Do a downtown business incubator, important because we'll come back to that. We wanted to take the 6 Mile Creek walkway that we had donated to the city alongside our gateway project along the creek there and tie it into the Mulholland Wildlife Preserve. We wanted a meeting center, a welcome center, more hotels. We wanted to restore the state theater. And if you'd like to read a tremendous prototype for strategic plans, just go to Downtown Ithaca 2020 strategic plan. And Gary's almost got the 2030 plan done, but you can really get a view of the multitude of projects and energy that's gone into that. Here's another hotel built on a vacant parking site right downtown, part of the plan, convincing a developer that this was the place to go, totally private. Another one, the Ithaca Hotel, modernized and expanded. And then look at this. This is Gateway, Seneca Way, the Hilton Garden Inns down this way. This site is right here. And you'll see in a second what it became. One of the major forces at work that both Thijs van Court, who this book is dedicated to, along with Gary, came up with, was this idea of the tax abatement, that if you built to a certain height, you would get a tax abatement of up to 100% for the first year, 90 the second, if you went up to the zoning limit. So, one of the important things that the BID did, and Gary led the charge on, was changing the zoning for downtown. And what you see there became that. You want to tell them how, Gary?
Well, I mean, the
192 units.
Yes, it's a $55 million project, but 192 units plus ground floor retail. We had to change the zoning. I mean, basically at that point in time, we had a one-story building and it was a six-story zone at the time, but or a 60-foot zone. But we worked with the city and I think the thought was we needed some places to put density in our community, and downtown was the place to do that. And that we rezoned to 140 feet. 140 feet, is pretty high. I mean, this ended up not being all of that, because actually when it first was penciled out and people saw what 140 foot building was there, they everybody got really nervous and said, oh my God, that's monolithic, it looked terrible. So it actually went through two developers. The first developer was from as a national developer from Georgia, and it was not successful. The second developer was from 30 miles away, and they understood the community. They had actually done the Seneca Way project just across the street, and came up with the concept for city center. And the result was, a marvelous infill project that took, I mean, this was urban renewal central. This lot had been torn down in the 60s, replaced with a one-story building where it stayed for, 50 years. And this was bringing this part of downtown back to its sort of glory. Of what it used to look like, although on a much grander scale. So this building was, there's some trepidation on the part of the community. Would this feels too big? It feels too, out of proportion. But you know what? Today it fits right in, and everybody seems to be very happy with it. And that retail along that area has really activated that street, and really created another block, another vital block where there wasn't one previously.
Good. This project, and I see my son Frost is on the call here today. He bought this project. He now runs our business. And it was built in 1924. The same owner that sold us Gateway sold this to Frost. And the president of Cornell had called me up and said, if you could provide 10,000 square feet of downtown office space rent-free for a year, we could raise $1 million through the Southern Tier Development Corporation and put it into the building. And I talked to Frost about it because he was the owner of this, and doggone if he didn't do it. They kept this attractive little building. It was not historical, but he added two floors, or he made this top floor part of the business incubator, the next floor, and then apartments above. And he went to New York and saw Bloomberg's miniature units, and that's what we've got. Whoops, sorry. That's what we've got in this building. Huge success. One of the strong things, powerful forces, is a request for proposals. The city had chosen me back in 1982 to be the developer for College Town, and I did that. We had a block downtown right behind, here's Center Ithaca, and this block with this helix in it had the potential of being a huge development. We found developers in Cincinnati, actually, Gary, I think you knew them, that said they won, the city chose them to come after hiring a couple of them that didn't work out. And here they are, Steve Bloomfield, this is the former mayor, our current mayor, Svante Tace Van Cort, our city planner, the new city planner, Gary and Ken, and they developed this site. I went to Cincinnati to see if they were for real, because I was present the bid and I wanted to know. And they were going to be huge competition for us. They ended up building this building across the street, and it was a big success. They brought Urban Outfitters, they started a pharmacy there. And I was very fearful of Center Ithaca and our apartments across the way about what would happen. But as it turned out, usually we'd enter the summer with out of our 62 apartments, I think it was, half of them would be rented for August occupancy. They were full, but it would take until August to get them rented for the following year. Well, the next year, 1st of June, they were rented. And the year after that, the 1st of May, and the year after that, the 1st of April. And that's about where it's hung right now, which meant, in my mind, that they had not taken my piece of the pie. They had expanded the pie. They made downtown through this project. It was one more reason to come downtown. And then they became the developer manager of the downtown 750 space parking garage and Cultivari, which is a farm to bistro restaurant that our community college put together. Density was a huge driver downtown, or creating it was a huge driver. This one-story building in the heart of downtown became 50 units of affordable housing due to this group, Ithaca Neighborhood Housing. They bought it and developed it. One of the things that Gary brought to town were different lecturers. And we had at least one, two actually, Kunstler and another one, who talked about preserving your architectural heritage. And historic Ithaca sort of grew out in the 60s from the urban renewal, I won't say debacle, but certainly the program that was tearing down all the historic old buildings in downtown. And they saved this building, built in 1828, Ezra Cornell had owned it at one point, from demolition in 1970. It was close to bankruptcy. In 2008, my wife was on the board. They had been borrowing money to keep this building, the State Theater, another historic structure, open, and they owed more than $1 million. We put a project together financially with community help and the banks and our family and a few friends that saved this building. And today it's a 150 student charter school with offices above. This project, Gary, you want to just quick talk about how that happened?
Well, yeah, like a lot of cities around the country, most of our downtowns had performance theaters or lots of old theaters. We had actually six of them in our downtown at one point in the early 1900s. By the time I know I got to town, there was one active theater. Actually, it wasn't even open at the time. It had just reopened, which is the State Theater, which you see here, 1600 seat theater built in 1928. It's an incredibly beautiful place inside. There's the picture of it. And a nonprofit historic preservation group bought it and tried to run it as a theater. They were really good at doing historic preservation. They were not so good at running theaters. By the end of the decade, they were in a position of basically preparing to go bankrupt as an organization and losing in this building, about to lose this building. Mac and Carol, who you see there, were convinced to step in. They actually purchased the theater. They also purchased, and the package included the other assets of historic Ithaca, which was the Clinton House, which you just saw there. And from that, we were able to create a new nonprofit organization, State Theater Inc., which by today now has this theater running in the black, although this year has not been a great year for it. We created a new board, of which Mac and I served on as founding members. And like I say, it's Mac held paper on this for and still does, and it's really been, it was a great instance of a community leader really stepping up and saying, we can't let our last remaining theater disappear. And the feedback and the results speak for themselves. And this is one of our great assets and one of our great destinations for visitors and for foot traffic in downtown. And it happened because of our, you know, because of Mac and because of people like him step forward to really help with this.
Another project right on the commons, took a long time, years to put together. The man owned these three buildings. This is what he built. And it's a good example of the city being involved and planning being involved. We wanted to keep the opening or the front of the building on the commons. Nothing could go higher than 60 feet. Fine, he steps back another 60 or so feet and goes up to 14 stories. Real, I want to say public-private discussion anyway. The guy was amazing. The commons itself was 40 years old. It was coming apart. We had to tear it up and put it back together. And this is what we created with these iconic entrances, these the visible stores now, open topography. And this is why we do it. How many events, Gary, does the BID sponsor now downtown?
Dozens, yeah.
70 or 80. And this is one of them, the Apple Harvest Festival. Now, all of this is going on pre-COVID, and it's part of what has made Ithaca so strong that we were able to get approval, and it's actually under construction now, for two floors of a conference center and 182 low-mod income apartments and a reconfigured parking garage. That's just a rough rendering of it. This project, and it's interesting how the architects don't show anything else along here when they're doing their building. The owner of the Marriott is building, I'm not sure if I got my number correct, Gary, 182 or so market.
200.
All right. And then this shows the entire block. All of this has happened, literally come together, I would say, in terms of approvals in the last year, hasn't it, Gary, right through COVID?
Yeah, I think the real takeaway here is the city own that all you see there was an existing parking garage that was built in 1970s, and you know, it has basically lived its life and was actually to the point now where spaces were being closed down because they were dangerous. It had to be rebuilt or demolished. Something had to happen to it, and so the city very wisely opted to instead of just taking on this project and just redoing the parking garage and being done, they actually said, well, wait a minute, we own a valuable asset. We could actually have a developer build on this site so long as they build back our parking. And so they put out another RFP looking for developers, and they selected one who was developing two-thirds of the space, and another second developer is developing the other third of the space. So as Mac mentioned, you know, this is a tremendous gain. The city got its parking back. Actually, are we going to net another 100 spaces? But we're getting nearly 400 units of housing. We're getting a conference center. We're getting more retail. You know, it's a tremendous net gain for the community. And all those housing units, half of them are, you know, 200 of them are affordable. Right in the heart of the city, which is a really important need that we have. Somebody asked about working with marginalized populations, and one of our big issues clearly is affordability. And the and the challenge of, in a market like we're trying to put together here, how do you put affordable units in the middle of your city? And so, you know, this is an example of we've been able, half of these units are what we would call affordable, you know, low-income housing units that would be available to working class people.
Workforce housing. So if you think back to what started with, this is the parking area on the Gateway site. My son and daughter now own the entire site. And these are in site plan review, 347 units, another $81 million of development. And that's really our presentation. We're happy to running a little bit over, but if we can answer questions at the end while other people are, after everybody's had a chance to present, be happy to. So thank you very much for listening.
I was going to say, Mac, we do have a put together a little two-page set of notes to sort of summarize the sort of the Ithaca experience. And I think that I know Bill Ryan was going to find a way to make sure they get out to folks. So
okay. And for all of us, this isn't just about Ithaca. And the book is not just about Ithaca. Recognize these major drivers in your city: arts, dining, entertainment, density, the tools we used, which were very effective, the bid, the strategic plans, all the public discussion, the zoning changes, and tax abatements. Bill told me he's got about 30 more books he could send out to people. So I hope you're interested in that. And thank you very much for sitting through this with us.
Thank you, Mac. Thank you, Gary. Very nice presentation. Can I have the liberty to ask one question? Kind of kick off this ending. Ithaca is built on a lake bed, and it's a 400 foot climb from downtown to the Cornell campus and 400 feet from downtown to the Ithaca College campus. And that's equivalent to a 40 story building within a short walk. And I'm saying to myself, who's gonna walk from Cornell or Ithaca College downtown to that that steep hill in the cold weather? And and then I read someplace in one of your plans that Gary had proposed a trolley. And I think it's a great idea. But that seems like it's going to be moving a monster to get that one through.
There has been a stretch. I've tried that twice now, and so far I've gotten that handed back to me. We have been able to get a shuttle that goes back and forth to Cornell every 10 minutes, so that's helped immeasurably. And we continue to work with our transit. I mean, as we're putting together our 2030 strategic plan, I mean, this issue still exists. How do we better connect our central business district with other districts, with other key attractions like the universities and the waterfront? And that connectivity will be, I think, the acid test for how well we as a community fare in the future. If we can't connect ourselves and move people efficiently and sustainably and rapidly, between places, it's gonna pose a problem. So, that's one of our key issues that as we look forward to the next 10 years, that I think as a community we have on our table, to try to get a better remedy for. But like I said, we have a shuttle that goes to Cornell. We still don't have very good service to IC or to the waterfront. So that's a work in progress for us.
Any immediate questions, these guys? In the back of the book, it says that I guess Danter company saying that Ithaca is a laboratory for trying new things because of its topography, because of its different market segments. But I'm guessing downtown Ithaca isn't just about college students. It's about people that live in the region and tourists and visitors and others. Did you guys see it too?
Yeah, when I like to tell people our market in terms of when you look at retail patronage comes from three places primarily. Our local residents make up about a third of that. Our students make up about a third of it, and our visitors make up about a third of it. But we are rapidly seeing that visitation is becoming more and more important. During the pandemic, it was essential. Ithacans have been very cautious, and frankly, one of the reasons why we've done so well, you know, through the pandemic is we've really been a shining light of people who have tried to beat this pandemic by doing the right thing. But that meant we didn't go out a lot. We still got a lot of visitation, and visitors really kept our businesses alive. And, you know, we expect that to continue.
Bill, I just noticed a chat from Carrie about they don't have enough return on investment for developers. We don't either. And it makes a huge difference when the city will get involved and either secure a site and make it available for not much money, or where they will institute a tax abatement that will save on taxes. When we bought the Gateway site, the taxes were $30,000 and they're $300,000 a year now. So it allows you to get involved and grow as the market grows. So there are ways to improve the bottom line that aren't just, that require public input. I mean, they're grants. We have an economic development system for New York State that has helped us, the National Development Council, things like that.
Yeah, I think the lesson here is, I think you don't take that as a final answer that, that they don't pencil out, I guess we can't do projects. The answer is, all right, let's show everybody why they don't pencil out. And so, in fact, I remember sitting with some of the people on this call, having those very discussions about that very topic. And I mean, the solutions were, we came up with this tax abatement program that could help subsidize projects, incent developers to come, to kind of make those pro forma tighten up and make the shave some of those gaps. And then, like Max said, I mean, you know, if you can save money on acquisition by having the city involved in the process, if you can get additional grant monies in, if you can use tax credits. All those things can enter into the picture to try to help make projects possible. And I think part of our roles are to try to do that, to not take no for an answer and to say, all right, what is it going to take to get from here to there? And I think that's what we tried to do in Ithaca, because absolutely right. When we first started this venture, we were in the exact same boat. There hadn't been downtown development generation. And all the development was happening on the edges of town. And there was a real worry, I think, on a lot of people's parts. Was downtown ever going to get growth? Because you know, who would invest there? So I think, you know, a lot of municipal and a lot of civic attention went into thinking about how to close those gaps. And I think we were able to do that.
And put out a request for proposals. If you know in your city that there's an area that might be of interest, that somehow you could influence who was chosen to develop it, put out a request for proposals, see what you get.
Well, we've got about 2 minutes before the next part of the program, part two, but two things I'd like to share with you. Lori, can you go back to that prior slide? The one with the wanted poster. While she's looking for that, I want to just recommend to everyone to get up by their desk and get some water, come back and do some stretching, and we'll plow through the second half. But let's see if we can get this poster up here. Something's moving. It should be the very first slide in the second deck. Coming up next will be a discussion of three cities in Wisconsin that have done some great things, exciting things, both during the pandemic and looking ahead of us where we're heading. in a way that's safe and that's helping to retain these cities, how they've been growing and who they are today. They're looked upon very well in the state as places, good places to live and do business. And Laurie, that slide might be the very end or the very beginning, I'm not sure.
Well, and you said it was in the second presentation or in the first one?
It'd be the second presentation.
Okay. Personally.
Well, why don't we wait? We'll get it fixed up for the end of the session.
Sure.
Let's go ahead and Joe, if you want to help me introduce our next speakers. This is going to be a visit to three cities in Wisconsin, Appleton, Eau Claire, and La Crosse. A little bit bigger than Ithaca, but doing some great things and impressive work despite the pandemic and the uncertainty around us. So starting off will be Joe. You want to introduce him?
Sounds good. First, we have Jennifer and Karen in Appleton. Jennifer Stefani serves as the executive director of Appleton Downtown Incorporated and of Creative Downtown Appleton. She has been with ADI for 18 years. Prior to that, she was executive director of the New London, Wisconsin Chamber of Commerce. She is also a longtime board member of the Wisconsin Downtown Action Council, as well as Arts Wisconsin. Karen Harkness has been director of community and economic development for the city of Appleton for the past 13 years. She focuses on economic development, neighborhood revitalization, housing rehabs, planning, zoning, and more. Prior to this, she was executive director of Future Nina Incorporated. All right, Jennifer and Karen.
Thank you. Are we able to share our screens? I can share a couple of slides, please. Maybe. Right. Thank you. I think I get the award for busiest slide today. Pretty excited about that. Good afternoon. Thanks so much for letting us be part of the conversation today. Wow, Ithaca, just setting the bar really high for business improvement districts around the world, and just an outstanding case study to share. Thank you so much. Well, we're here to share a little bit about Appleton, Wisconsin, and some of the projects that we took on during pandemic and kind of getting us through pandemic, keeping us focused on how to best to support our small businesses here, how to keep that activation rolling, how to continue the encouragement for spending in the district as well as investment in our district. So I'll kick off by sharing a little bit about how we continued that level of activation in our community. And then I'll hand it off to Karen to talk a little bit about the development tools here. So in terms of activation, we are rooted deep in event planning and hosting. And of course, throughout 2020, we were unable to do a lot of the regular events that we host. One of them that we really embraced and made a real effort to adapt into our new environment was our lunchtime concerts. And the concert series is typically hosted in a plaza downtown, lots of gathering. And of course, we couldn't do that. So we shifted gears a little bit and we created a series where we could host a singer-songwriter, solo or duo artist, and bring those artists to the restaurant that had outdoor seating. So we were promoting directly with our businesses. We covered the cost of those musicians and gave the musicians a gig, which we all know they kind of lost most of their paying gigs throughout the year. So we were able to keep that engagement with our local artists and bring a little boost to the lunch business for our downtown and riverfront restaurants. And we were lucky enough to have the partnership with the city of Appleton that helped to make outdoor dining even more prominent in our downtown, made it a little easier for them to expand their areas. And so we can really make that a highlight in our district and get people moving around and coming down and spending money. So that's one project that we're actually going to keep. We will no longer do a gathering concert for lunch. We're going to keep this format, and we're actually going to double it. We're going to do 2 days, Thursday and Friday, in our district. So we're really excited. It's one of those silver linings, right? And we had quite a few of those, actually, which we're really excited about. And one of those was public art, and it's forever a part of our program of work. And we really embraced that throughout pandemic and, of course, moving forward. And we hosted a couple of projects that we're really proud of. One is the Downtown Unites mural, which you see kind of in the corner of the slide here with the two hands, really celebrating the diversity and inclusion in our community. It was painted by a local mural artist, Arino Medina, and it's a beautiful piece. The other is our hope sculpture, which, I mean, quite literally, we wanted to bring a little hope to our downtown. And we did that in cooperation with our partner, the Bolt Company, here in Appleton. And it still sits in our plaza today. And you can sit with it, get your picture taken with it. And it really is a great symbol. So we're really proud of that one as well. And as we talked about, how do we adapt to this kind of new environment and keeping people safe and still hosting all of those events, just like Ithaca, in their bed? And we really wanted to embrace our walkability. And we're really fortunate here in Appleton that we have a mile stretch of this beautiful walkable downtown. We have wide streets in order to host some of these activities. But we know the walkability is super important to getting people moving around the district. So we hosted things like chalk art and ice carvings, and we got people moving around the district and keeping it safe. People could be within their pods, most of them wore face masks, but it translated into spending. It really did. People were downtown. There wasn't any extra sale or any extra passport or anything like that. It was literally come downtown, take a walk, and view the exciting, beautiful exhibits that we have. And it didn't cost a lot of money. These were inexpensive projects, but it got people down in the district and they spent money, and it was a wonderful thing. Marketing and promotions, of course, we're always promoting people to come into our district. And one promotion that we hosted was Support 920. Our area code being 920, we made a call to action to people, not just a message to shop local, because that becomes white noise after a while. But this was really a call to action. It was select 9 businesses, spend $20, take the pledge. Let us know that you're invested in downtown and you're here to support our downtown businesses. And it went viral in our community. It just went crazy. And the businesses loved it. We did oversized posters in the windows and hit it real hard with social media. And people really rallied around it. And it absolutely made a difference in our spending over the holiday season. And of course, investment in our district. So we kept our facade grant program strong throughout 2020, and we were actually able to add some dollars into that pot. Our business improvement district has a facade grant program, a business recruitment grant program, a marketing grant program. I mean, we made sure that those pots were secured in 2020 and actually grew the facade program, that we were able to partner with the city of Appleton on their TIF enhancement grant. And I'm going to pass the baton to Karen Harkness, the Community Development Director at the City of Appleton, to share a little bit about our TIF districts and how the TIF Enhancement Grant Program has really brought new investment into our district. Karen?
Thank you, Jennifer. So Jennifer just put up another slide that shows our tax incremental financing districts and our opportunity zone. So the districts are in color. Pink is district 12 and blue is district 11. And in between, the yellow is district 3. The reversed L shape is our opportunity zone. So we've created our tax incremental financing districts because unfortunately, New York is really blessed in being able to have tax abatement. The state of Wisconsin does not. So for those of you in Wisconsin, you know that our only economic development tool is tax incremental financing districts. So we create the districts where we see there's pent-up demand for development. I call it a self-help program. What happens is our developers get financing back called pay-as-you-go based on the increment tax that they create. So it's been very successful for us in the downtown area, and our next slide will show you some of the projects that we're working on. But within TIF 11 and TIF 12, we started business enhancement grants, and we started out small 3 years ago with $21,000. And it was so successful the first year, our council actually doubled that to $42,000 in each district for small business enhancement grants to our commercial businesses to really help eliminate blight and slum. It helps revitalize those areas. It increases our tax value. It promotes vitality and walkability to the downtown. And as Ithaca said, growth creates growth. It's the same thing when people are updating their commercial properties. When your neighbor updates it, it looks nicer. New windows, tech pointing. You want your business to look nice as well. So this has been extremely successful for us pre-COVID. But even during COVID, what we found out happened was because the businesses were dormant, they had the opportunity now to not disrupt the flow of their traffic, of their clients, and to invest in their business. And the business enhancement grant allows them to partner up to a $7,000 grant, and they need to invest one-to-one or $7,000, but they could use ADI's business enhancement grant for 25% of that investment. So what we've been able to see is in TIF 11, we've had about $200,000 in project investments, and the TIF investment has been about $56,000. In TIF 12, we've seen $150,000 in investment, and the TIF investment was about $40,000. These business enhancement grants were so popular in our TIF, we took that to our redevelopment authority and said, we'd like to do this program and duplicate it outside of our tax incremental financing districts downtown. So our redevelopment authority set aside $130,000 to do exactly that. And we've been so pleased with that development since we started, which was just about the time that COVID hit. We spent half of those funds, and it's been throughout the city, and it's been a multiple of sizes of businesses. And the investment per business is just shy of that $7,000 maximum. But we've seen a robust involvement with that. We've done 13 buildings in the city that's leveraged about $80,000 in owner investment, and we've only used about $65,000 of that $130,000 right now. And to date, since the TIF enhancement grants are 3 years old, we've done about $500,000 in investment in downtown properties in the last 3 years. So it truly has been very successful. Downtown residential projects, I'll start off with this, and Jennifer can add to this. So Ithaca shared with us how important a strategic plan is, and I have to support that. So we have our downtown comprehensive plan, which was unanimously approved by our council in March of 2017. And that plan, we did chapter 14 was a downtown chapter, and we did a housing study downtown. And what the housing study told us was that we could absorb 635 residential components between 2016 and 2021. And we had the same reaction from the community. 635 residential units, how in the world are you going to be able to do that? Well, we're doing it. And depending on where you count our downtown, kind of depends on where this goes. But we have more cranes on the horizon right now than we've seen in downtown Appleton in probably 3 years. So these are some of the projects that have come online post-COVID and during COVID, and we have three more projects that are in the queue and in the hopper that are being worked on right now. So to date, we've added 221 units. Depending on how you divide the downtown, you could add 110 additional units to that. So we kind of feel like we're halfway there. And we've been very mindful to make sure that everyone has the opportunity to live downtown. So we have some WETA tax credit projects that are low to moderate income. And that's why you see the rental rate is anywhere from 80 cents a square foot all the way up to $1.75 a square foot. So we have beautiful upscale apartments as well as the WETA tax credit projects. What makes a neighborhood is when everybody lives together. And so we've been very mindful to be able to do that. Jen, I'll let you add to this slide.
To see this level of investment in bringing new residential into our district, it has absolutely spurred other interest from businesses as well. Because now we have a whole nother level of meeting the needs of the new downtown residents. We've always had residents in our district, but this density is really making a huge difference for us. So we're really excited to see what that next phase of development and that next phase of business recruitment is gonna look like. So we feel like we're just off and running here and coming out of pandemic and really positioning downtown for this level of growth has been years in the works. And Karen and I have been lucky enough to work together for a lot of those years. And to see it all coming together is very rewarding and very exciting. So we're just excited to be part of the discussion and of course available for questions. Thanks.
Thank you, Jennifer and Karen. And I believe we are gonna save the questions until the end of the three of you or the three cities, if that's all right. All right, well, while Lori is getting the other presentation up, I'm gonna introduce our next speaker. He's from Eau Claire. So Aaron White wears multiple hats for Eau Claire. He is the economic development manager for the city of Eau Claire. He is the executive director for Downtown Eau Claire Incorporated, and he's executive director of the Eau Claire Redevelopment Authority. Through all three, he promotes economic growth in the downtown through development, business expansion, business recruitment, and promoting the downtown. He hails from Kansas, where he worked for and served on several boards and other councils, and he currently sits on the board of directors of the Wisconsin Economic Development Association.
Thank you, appreciate being here. The shot, we have the screenshot. I'm keeping my slide show very, very basic. The slide that we're showing is kind of the jewel of the downtown area. And I think it tells the story for the community that our path through COVID really started with our path prior to COVID. The community over a decade ago decided to make the conscious decision to redevelop what at the time was a heavily blighted downtown area. Significant investment by developers, by the city in infrastructure, brought new energy and new life to the downtown, focusing on making it pedestrian and bicycle friendly, encouraging folks to slow down and travel through the community. Those investments in infrastructure led to investments in the rest of the businesses, which brought new businesses in town, which brought new developers into town, and created a huge cultural vibe in the community that's based around arts, it's based around entertainment, music, and was really driving a huge amount of growth right up until COVID came. For our reactions to COVID, when the shelter in place first was implemented in March in 2020, our first role that the downtown group really took on was to start funneling information to our businesses. There was a lot of questions about what's going on, what's gonna happen, who's gonna help us, how's this gonna affect my business. We started out by creating a new landing page within our website, my team did, and started compiling all the information from local, state, and federal resources. We had links to the SBA, we had links to the EDA, we had links to the WEDC, which is Wisconsin Economic Development Corporation, the regional planning commissions, our local resources, and then we actively promoted those links to the businesses to make sure they could keep information up to date on what was available for assistance. Every time a new program or a new federal response of stimulus came down, we updated our links, we updated our application forms. All of them were available at a click of a button from one page within our downtown. We also implemented, put up guidelines and tips on how to fill out and prepare for the forms. And really made a strong push to make sure that our businesses were well informed of what was coming down the line in terms of assistance. The next thing we started looking at is how we could provide some direct assistance from a planning standpoint. Some simple efforts that we implemented immediately were to first off, waive some of the fees that would be required from typical permitting, doing things like our sidewalk cafes, some of the things that would normally have an event permit or something tied to it, those fees were waived through most of the summer. We also immediately designated several parking spaces in the downtown area scattered throughout the district as no longer as parking spaces, but flagged as curbside pickup only. Feedback from our businesses that particularly the restaurants that were not set up to do delivery or curbside, having a place where a customer could roll in, pick up a meal, and then roll back out became really important. And we had over a dozen at one point in time curbside pickup locations scattered through downtown. We also mapped these out digitally, put these on our website so customers and folks looking at the community could easily find those spaces and know where they can go to park, pick up, to go, and then take off. We also immediately started implementing some basic programming to encourage folks to still engage with our downtown businesses. My staff immediately went out and purchased $1,000 worth of gift cards from local downtown businesses, and then started running virtually based events to encourage people to kind of keep engaged with the downtown. One of the first ones was a photo contest, send us your favorite image of downtown. And had awarded prizes for that, which were gift cards to our existing businesses. We did a virtual scavenger hunt where people could go out and identify unique things or key points of interest in the downtown area digitally. And again, awarding them those who completed the scavenger hunts and hit some of those metrics were awarded gift cards to businesses in the downtown area. So that immediately helped drive some traffic and business down to our businesses that were located and were impacted by the shelter at home. Our organization, Downtown Eau Claire Inc., has an incredibly engaged board of directors. And so having that support was really helpful. One of the first things we did was we looked at the reserve funds that the DECI was sitting on and what can we do to help do some immediate impacts, some immediate benefits to businesses. So we immediately released and created a small grant program, $1,500 grants available to businesses that were specifically impacted by the Safer at Home, retail restaurants and those types of businesses that can operate under the Safer at Home operations. We did two rounds of that grant funding and ultimately gave out over $80,000 in grants to our local downtown businesses to provide some assistance to help them kind of weather the storm as much as we could. From a broader standpoint, we also implemented a marketing campaign. Hashtag Root for EC became the basis for a marketing campaign to kind of reintroduce and keep people engaged with the downtown area. Heavily focused on digital and video. We had a 2-minute video shot highlighting different businesses and business owners, and then several 30-second segments that were heavily promoted through social media, available through our website. On YouTube, had great response and great engagement from the marketing program. And we ran that for a 3-month campaign once the Safer at Home order was lifted in July. The community as a whole also got together and engaged in a very unique way. The community created a task force. It involved city, county, surrounding communities, as well as a number of businesses and nonprofits to engage and meet weekly and help identify the needs of the community to help do a recovery and help speed along the recovery. It was the Chippewa Valley Economic Recovery Task Force. It was a heavily engaged group. It included, the Chamber of Commerce, the Visit Eau Claire, neighboring government of Altoona, the county level, city level. We spent a lot of time reaching out to businesses and engaging with them, finding out what their needs are, where could we assist, what messages do we need to put out to the community and to the region to make sure that folks are staying and aware of what's going on. So individual websites were created. It became a compendium of all resources that were available to businesses impacted by COVID. Again, keeping the idea of a one-stop shop where a business could go to a location, follow a single link and click onto all the resources that were available to them. And we kept it updated. We also implemented a variety of marketing programs within that, particularly focusing on video, promoting particularly like social distancing, the opportunity to engage in businesses through e-commerce and kind of remote ways to do that, how to operate safely as businesses opened up after the Safer at Home was released. We started doing marketing campaigns and promotions on how to safely reopen your business. They even created a branded program for businesses that were signing on to follow the recommended checklist for reopening your business that was put out by the state through the health department. We created a decal and branding program in businesses. Over 200 of those were filled out. And those decals showed up on businesses who had committed to following safe reopening practices that were advised by the state health department and the local health department. So a very heavily engaged group. As we move forward, we're continuing to branch our message out. We are getting ready to launch through Downtown Claire Inc. again, a second video campaign, kind of again re-engaging and reintroducing folks to our community. We're also looking to branch out further. We're looking to target more towards the Twin Cities area, really expanding our audience and what areas we're attracting to or we're reaching to try and re-engage folks to come back and rediscover what folks knew prior to COVID, which is a really unique entertainment, arts, and music culture in the downtown area. We continue to work closely with other partners in the community, the Chamber of Commerce, the Eau Claire Area Economic Development Corporation, our Visit Eau Claire. We meet monthly to share information, and that type of collaboration has been a really big piece of helping us, you know, move information into the community and into our businesses. That type of information sharing, you know, oftentimes these organizations operate in silos and they do their thing and somebody does their else thing and they don't worry about the overlap. But for us, the overlap is actually a strength where we've been able to reinforce messaging to bring folks back to the downtown and how to help businesses move forward safely. On the finance side, we also secured an EDA grant, and we have a loan pool through the community for different programs. It has about just over $1 million in lending that's done towards small businesses. And that's something that we've been operating for over 30 years. We also secured a $500,000 grant from the EDA to do the EDA CARES loan, which is a separate pool of funding from the EDA designed to assist businesses impacted by COVID. It's a zero interest loan with deferred payments. And we've made, to date, we've made 430,000 in loans through that pool. It does one of two things. Some businesses, it's helped them cover some costs to let them keep operating until business improves. For some others, they used it as an opportunity to change how they do business, implementing new point of sale systems that allow them to do more efficient curbside pickup or to better engage in e-commerce. So they've been able to upgrade their operation to become what will likely be a much more viable operation moving out of COVID. So we're very excited to see what was happening there. The community has recently passed two new ordinances. We have a new parklet ordinance and a scooter share program ordinance that were passed by city council in the last few weeks. The parklet will allow businesses in the downtown area to take a parking space in front of their operation and convert it into a place where they can engage and becomes an extension of their premise. We have interest from some cafes and restaurants to do something like that. And we're looking to see how well that goes, how well it's maintained and operated. And we've been talking to businesses and are open to the idea of maybe expanding that into potentially like street cafe or street dining or street retail operations where we may potentially, you know, close a segment of one of the downtown streets, you know, for 30 days and allow the businesses to spill into that area as kind of a unique warm weather type of event or venue. We are also very much an event-based organization. A lot of our early events, we shifted to a variety of digital platforms, really encouraged folks to also engage in events, just walking through the downtown area. A lot of window type display events and competitions amongst the businesses that invites people to come down, walk through the community and kind of look at, you know, what's going on in the stores while engaging safely. We're hoping to start seeing some live events. We actually have one coming up in May, and then we are working with a lot of other organizations to start seeing some events open up towards the end of summer, early fall, keeping a very close watch on how to make sure we do that safely, following all the governance and guidance from the state and the health department to maintain social distancing, masking, et cetera. One of the things we're looking at now too is we're anticipating a rush of new visitors coming in, or a rush of attendance at some of these events that have been longstanding. We think we're gonna exceed attendance significantly over what we'd normally see for that event in years past, just because there's a pent up interest in getting out and doing things. We saw that just this last weekend with the Eau Claire cleanup day, that was last Saturday. They had over 900 people sign up for this event, and that's double or even triple what normally is enrolled to go out and spend a morning cleaning up around the community. So we're now looking at how we can facilitate parking and use of shuttles or things like that to find parking areas for people to come and then just bring them to the downtown area through shuttle systems, instead of trying to find ways to park everyone at, you know, at numbers that we probably haven't ever seen before. So those are some of the things that we're looking at now as well. Continuing to move forward on the development side, a lot of projects that were put on pause in early 2020 have started up again. We just broke ground on a new 90,000 square foot mixed use facility that broke ground about a month ago. We have two more projects breaking ground this late summer, including a new children, the new location for the Children's Museum, and a new transit transfer center that will have units of residential on top of that as a private public partnership. We just signed an MOU for a new 240 unit development that will go in the Cannery District. And we are engaged in two other developers looking at space in the Cannery District as well, which is a defined area of the downtown. We've made extensive use of tax increment financing as well. We also have four business improvement districts in the downtown area that are continuously looking at how they can better improve the pedestrian experience. Bike racks, benches, landscaping items, banners, all with branded districts, are all funded by the four bids in the downtown area and provide a really good pedestrian experience or a walking experience for folks that are coming to the community. They're continually investing within their districts to do more to keep the area, the downtown area, vibrant, keep attracting it, and keep folks coming in. Our board is also continuously looking at better ways to market, better services that we can deliver. We've been refining our website and also creating additional landing pages for all four bid districts within our downtown the DECI website, so we can better brand and identify the bids and who are participating within the bids. We're pushing much more digital formats and publications, expanding our digital presence greatly with some of the staff changes that we've had over the last 2 years, who bring much greater experience in digital marketing than we've had in the past. So we're seeing some really exciting things coming through on the digital side. As we look moving forward, one thing that we actually done is we've actually stopped doing RFPs for our properties that we're looking to develop. What we have found is that hiring a consultant and coming in, the Cannery District is a prime example. We had a master redevelopment district created in late 2019, identifying a general development theme that we'd like to see occur within that area downtown. And as opposed to in years past where we'd send an RFP, we'd get one or two responses, and then they have to pick the winner. And then if it doesn't go through, you have to start the whole process over again. We simply create a theme or an idea of development in an area, and then we send it out to the development world and invite them to look at what we'd like to see happen in the downtown area, these very general developments, and then invite them to apply for or submit a proposal on a site that, you know, they identify this part of the development as, yeah, that's something that's right within our wheelhouse, we'd like to do it. They reach out to us direct and we work a deal directly. The cannery district had kind of stalled for a number of years until we went this new route. And we, as I said, we broke ground in 2019 on a development that's getting ready to break phase two. We are just inked a MOU to develop additional 240 units of housing and the last of the sites. We also just signed a purchase agreement to develop another 2-acre parcel that will be not multifamily, but townhome type houses for sale at affordable price points. And we're working on two other developments and two other slots. So the new process, not doing RFPs, is actually working for us. We also had a number of developers tell us that they have stopped answering RFPs. Some of the ones that we've worked with said that RFPs they found are a little too restrictive, and they've just stopped responding to them. They simply go out and find development spaces that they want to do and develop the way they would like to. So we think this new process of just defining a concept for an area and then opening it up for developers to submit what they feel comfortable doing, which is within their wheelhouse, which is in their investment. And as long as it meets our general plans for development in an area, we think this is gonna be a more efficient process moving forward. But really exciting things occurring in the downtown area. Gonna continue to, one of the biggest pieces we can still continue to do for us is keeping the information flowing to our local businesses about additional assistance coming down. Generating information from them, you know, the idea of doing a street cafe, if it's something that appeals to them, we're open to ideas and we're making sure that they know we're open to ideas that may potentially help their business moving forward. So kind of drinking from the hose there, I'll leave it at that and let the next presentation move on.
Thank you, Aaron. All right, and last but not least, we have Carl and Andrea from La Crosse. Carl Green is the Community Natural Resources and Economic Development Agent for the La Crosse County Extension Office and has been a professor at UW Extension's Community Development Institute in La Crosse for the past 16 years. His main focus is local government issues such as tax abatement or tax-based development, housing, and neighborhood development. And Andrea Train is the Director of Planning, Development, and Assessment at the City of La Crosse. She works closely with businesses, developers, and economic development partners to improve the social, economic, and environmental landscape of La Crosse. Previously, she worked for 12 years at an international development company in Denver and at a foreign public policy think tank in Washington, D.C. Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. I'll go through the slides relatively quickly. If you can advance to the next one, please. I am going to give a little bit of background of the City of La Crosse and some of the issues that we deal with, and then Andrea will talk about our response post-COVID. La Crosse had a strong history of being a manufacturing community between tractor parts, beer. You can see the world's largest six-pack is one of the things that we had previously been known for. And sometime in the, I think, 80s, 90s, and on, we had transitioned more to a economy that was based on healthcare, the universities that we have. La Crosse is at the heart of the Driftless area. If anybody doesn't know what that is, Google Driftless area. We're a population of about 51,000, and we've stayed at that population for the last probably 6 to 7 decades. Post-World War II, we shot up to around 50,000. We've pretty much stayed there. However, the county of La Crosse, the urban area around the City of La Crosse, has grown pretty significantly. But we still are the hub of the sort of the center of this community. Next slide, please. We're on the banks of the Mississippi, and we are sandwiched in the Mississippi River Valley with the bluffs on our east side. And historically, you know, as this economy of universities and healthcare focus has grown, we kind of told ourselves we were this recession-proof place because people are still going to get sick, students are still going to go to college. A lot of services and jobs really are supportive to the those markets. We have a lot of rental housing that focuses on student housing. Our downtown has a lot of restaurants and bars. You know, there's just a lot of things that are focused on that student demand. And again, that these jobs are gonna stay during most any recession. However, following the COVID outbreak, things really got scary, I think, for us locally. Local healthcare stopped elective surgeries. They began furloughing employees. The universities were closing because of in-person classes and the requirement of social distancing. And they were starting to move online, and we started thinking, what is going to happen? And it just was, you know, this smoke coming from COVID that, you know, really everybody was trying to just figure out where we are and what we were going to do. So I'll turn this over now to Andrea. Next slide, please.
Should I be sharing my screen with the, okay, there we go, thank you. Okay, so thinking back to March when COVID started to hit everywhere, I remember getting phone calls while we were still in the office, and City Hall in La Crosse is still closed to this day. So thinking about how long ago that was, and businesses were immediately calling me, and I was trying to turn around and reach out to as many businesses to figure out what we could do immediately. So the first thing that we did is we put a pause on all city loan payments. So we have a pretty robust small business development loan program through our CDBG funding already. And so we let all the businesses that had outstanding loans with us know, hold off on those, pay your bills, pay your employees, do what you need to do. So that was the first step that we took in showing the solidarity that we had with the businesses, that we were in this with them and we wanted to do everything that we could do to help. Next, we started having business roundtables. So working with our downtown Main Street organization to put together roundtables. We did some separately with business that were with restaurant owners versus retail owners to figure out what their needs were immediately. And then we launched the Small Business Relief Grant Program. And we had this up and running, I believe it was in the very beginning of April. So a pretty immediate response. Our council was on board with us doing whatever we could. We used a source of city funds and then also used some of our community development block grant funds that had already been designated for small business programs. And we allocated those through an application process between $1,000 and $25,000 per business based on the number of full-time equivalent employees. So that was extremely successful. I think we gave out about 80 grants right away. And then we continued to supplement that grant program with other CARES CDBG funds that we received throughout the year, and we still do have a program going. So besides the Small Business Relief Grant Program, as some of the other presenters were mentioning, we maintained a COVID-19 resources website. So reaching out to our Small Business Development Center and WEDC and WEDA, making sure that we had all the latest and greatest of resources that were available to them. And then one other thing that kind of pushed us a little bit was outdoor cafes were something that historically had not been permitted in the city of La Crosse. There was the interpretation or the way the ordinance was written was that we were not able to take beverages outside of the property line. So meaning the right of way, we weren't able to have outdoor cafes throughout our community. And we were able to work with the clerk's office and work with our legislators to make sure that, and our policymakers to make sure that we could make some adjustments to those policies to keep businesses open. And I think that was a really big success. And like I mentioned, it had been something that had been talked about for years and years and years, probably decades, and nothing ever happened about it because of that interpretation. But this really forced us to move forward and make sure that we could help the businesses out to keep people outside, especially in the summer. One of the projects, probably the biggest project that's going on in the city right now is River Point District. So this is a 60-acre development just outside of our typical downtown. So just north of the area where the La Crosse, Black, and Mississippi Rivers meet. And this is a former industrial site that the city's been working on for over the last 20 years. So it's a project with the Redevelopment Authority. And we had anticipated that this project would have been further along by now, but of course issues happen, especially being a brownfield site. But looking back on it, 2020 was really the perfect opportunity for this site to start to really come together. So we took that time to work on infrastructure. We're putting a lot of fill in the site to raise it out of the floodplain, and then did even more developer outreach than we ever thought that we could. So Phil is going into that site now. We've got a couple of developers lined up. And looking back on it, it was a good time. If that were to ever happen, we're glad it happened in 2020. And then at the beginning of this year, we worked with a group to do a market analysis. So this gave us a more accurate indication of what could happen on this site. So looking at our housing and our office needs in our community, and knowing that this study now was done post-COVID, it feels more accurate, and we can sell this more to our community and to developers who are interested in this, because we have the latest and greatest data on hopefully how we expect what our needs are, what we expect our needs in our community to be. And then the next development that we had was the La Crosse Center. So this is our convention center, which is located downtown. This is a project that started in November of 2019. It's a $42 million construction project. And part of the community we heard from a lot, they saw this project was going on, and we heard from a lot of people saying, you should stop this project. There are so many needs in our downtown, so many needs in our community. Why are you putting all this money into this look to the La Crosse Center? We should really halt this and reallocate our funds. Well, part of it being, you know, we borrowed funds particularly for this project. So we weren't really able to just turn around and use those funds somewhere else, but also it kept a lot of people working through this process, with construction workers being an essential working group. There was a lot of activity going on, and it really gave the downtown a sense of being able to look forward, a sense of progressiveness for our downtown, that we were still working and planning on the future and not completely panicking and halting everything that was happening in our community. So this site we increased the size of La Crosse Center from 165,000 square feet to 310,000 square feet, building in a ballroom that actually now overlooks the river. Before, right behind this building that you see here in this picture is the Mississippi River, but we didn't have really event space that actually engaged with the river. So now building in some changes to take advantage of our beautiful amenities in our community. And we also had the opportunity to host the 2021 WIAA High School State Basketball Tournament this year. So that's not something that we had typically done before, and ended up having $1 million fiscal impact on the city. And again, it's one of those things that really provided some hope and excitement for the community while we were all dealing with, you know, things that seemed really hopeless through most of COVID. And then we're still thinking about long-term impact. Community engagement was one thing that we really struggled with. We started working on the update of our downtown master plan in February of 2020. And one of our guiding principles of that downtown master plan was community engagement. So we had been talking about doing this plan. It was due. We knew that we wanted to reach as many people as we could, really be very inclusive in this plan. And then when COVID hit, we thought that was just going to be out the window, that we talked about just completely scrapping the idea for a while. But in the end, we worked with a consultant who did a really good job of transforming the way that we did community engagement. So changing a lot of it online. And they've actually said that with this downtown master plan, they've had more community engagement on this project than they have with any other project they've worked on. And I think some of that is attributable to being able to do things online from the comfort of your home, not having to go home after work, change clothes, run to an elementary school cafeteria and do your community engagement session there, whatever you need to do. But people were able to do it more on their own terms and from the comfort of their own home. One thing that was mentioned before that Carl mentioned was the size of La Crosse. So we, and having our education and our medical institutions in La Crosse, so we're still the employment hub, even if the outside community's population is growing more, but those people are still coming into the city of La Crosse to work. So office space is something that we've been a little bit concerned about, wondering if everyone stays working from home, what is that downtown scene going to look like after work? Where are the happy hours? Where are the restaurants? How are the retail businesses going to be affected by people no longer being downtown? So that's something that we're still trying to look at. And even when having a discussion recently about the ARP funds that are coming in, and with not knowing that there's not really complete guidance on how we would use those, but what can we do to help out some of these long-term impact issues? So can we assist businesses with technology upgrades in their office, or sanitation and ventilation upgrades in their office, to be able to make people feel more comfortable coming back into the office space? And same with commuter traffic then. So with people coming outside of the city, we want to make sure that they're still coming into the city while still making improvements for our community members. And then big box retail's been a big problem all over the country, all over the state, but especially in La Crosse too. We have two vacant Shopcos, a vacant Kmart. Our major mall has lost three of the anchor stores. So while trying to still focus on our downtown and deal with all these issues, those other issues that we were dealing with pre-pandemic are still there. So how will that continue, and what can we do to try to help some of that out? And then next slide. So that's, I guess that's it. That's the wrap up.
Thank you both. All right, Bill, do you wanna kick off this next part or?
Hey, unmute works. Joe, you there?
Yes, we can hear you now. Yep.
Okay, someone returned my video to me. What's that here? Start your video. Okay, there's no button on it to start. Oh, down here. Okay. Good job, guys. I'll tell you, all the amount of work that you're doing is paying off. And you know what would be helpful? What Ithaca did, Gary just did this half an hour ago, or actually last night. He put together some of the high points of the quick low-hanging fruit takeaways on Ithaca and their progress and what they've done. And if you guys have the same kind of thing or put it together into a two-pager, we'll share it with the entire group. So consider that if you can do that, because you got some rich information here that will really help us. It's almost 3 o'clock, right? Eastern Central Time, it's almost 4 o'clock, another 10 minutes. So we might get out 10 minutes early. I think I'd like to, first of all, bring that picture back of that guy in the wanted poster, can you, Lori?
I can't do that, Bill. I deleted it.
Oh, okay. I'll find my way to get it. It's just an example of a person who, I shouldn't say just, it's an example of a person who made it through COVID-19, but in doing so, took a lot of risks of himself and the safety of his family to help someone else out. He donated his kidney to me last November, and it was really a totally voluntary act of kindness on his part. And it's meant a lot to me, and so I took the liberty, kind of pushing the liberty here, to share a picture of him and a funny picture with a wanted poster around him, because he's a real hero in my eyes. His name is Ed Smidowish, and I'm very, very thankful for him. Let's get back onto our topic. We're still hanging in there. A good number of people are still with us. Most of the people are still with us. Stretch if you have to, move your arms around, get off your butt if you have to, and let's go through the last part here. This part is your part, and we've talked a lot about what we're doing in these four communities. And now it's time to kind of take it home with us. And we're hoping that the participants will be not just the speakers, but also you, the participants in this second session. So we're collecting questions and answers, and we're gonna pose them to you. And you can give us a quick answer by text, or if you wanted to try it by voice, we could try that as well. Any preference in the poll here? Can we do that in the poll? Or maybe a combination of both things. Is that okay with everyone? Okay. Well, I'm gonna ask Melissa, who's taking close notes of the chat, What kind of topics are arising that we can frame into a question, Melissa? Melissa Kono, are you there?
I've had a couple comments in the chat recently. Mike asks about more of a COVID-specific question about the number of business closures on the ground floor space. Was it more or less than what you expected? And that's for our most recent panelists, I believe.
I guess, Andrea, if you have something to say as well, but I think that a lot of the businesses were able to kind of coast through this year relatively unscathed because of both the local efforts that we did, the La Crosse County as well, halted loan payment requirements. But then with the PPP loans and the federal stimulus that was coming in, interesting fact is our sales tax revenue actually increased in 2020. La Crosse County as a county fiscally is doing very well. I think what we saw was simply a shift from where it was being spent. While that has impacted our hotels and our restaurants, I don't know if, you know, because they were able to sort of maintain with the PPP loans, as well as the changes Andrea spoke about with the outdoor cafes, I think we made it work enough that we really haven't seen just a huge exodus of businesses at this point. So I'm hopeful that that will be, you know, how it moves forward and that we won't see much loss.
I would add to that that our vacancy rate in downtown was extremely low before, and it continues to be low. Of course, we did lose a couple of restaurants and a couple of retail spaces, but a lot of those have already been backfilled. So it hasn't had too much of a negative impact. And I was excited when I heard that statistic that Carl just shared regarding the retail sales tax or the sales tax in general, that is pretty promising. And we did do a shop local campaign, which I'm sure most cities across the country did, but it seems to be that, you know, I think that was probably pretty effective as well.
And this is Aaron White with Eau Claire. I'd echo Carl and Andrea's comments. Our community and the businesses so far have weathered things fairly well. We did see some permanent closings, but not nearly as many as we had feared or anticipated. However, I put that as a big caveat. Depending on how long customers for some of our industry stay away or continue to reduce the amount of patronage they do, we probably have some businesses that will be at risk longer term. A lot, particularly in the travel and lodging industry, a lot of the hotels and folks that we work with and have talked with are anticipating a turnaround late second quarter of this year. Should that not materialize, I think we'll probably see some other challenges for some of the businesses who have survived so far this long, but they can't survive on reduced revenues indefinitely. So it's something we'll be continuing to watch with them.
Yeah, this is Karen Harkness, and I would echo everything everybody else has said. We have been really hard hit in our hospitality, entertainment, and industries here, probably more so than a lot of areas in Wisconsin, because we rely very heavily on our businesses to support those. And our large corporations, like everybody else, right? There's no travel. Many of them aren't back to work yet. So the employees aren't downtown to be able to shop or to eat. So we're looking at doing a master tourism study and really trying to get in front of what do we need to do in order to position ourselves to come out stronger than we were going into it. Our data shows it's going to be 2024 before those hospitality entertainment industries recover.
We're actually hearing from some of our restaurants now that really the challenge is finding employees. And as business is starting to pick up a little bit, they're really struggling with being able to find a workforce. So we're having a lot of conversation collectively with our Convention and Visitors Bureau, the Chamber of Commerce, what kind of program or messaging can we put out about getting teens back to work and creating a safe environment for folks to enter into the hospitality industry. It seems to be a real challenge right now.
Good point.
And I just posted a thing on what we've found at Wisconsin Main Street. We do track a lot of numbers with the communities that we work in. And so I posted those to the chat just now.
Thanks, Joe.
One of the other questions was, how do the presenters see their efforts as tools to address the future rural development trends suggested by E2 University's pandemic implications for rural America? And that includes rising necessity entrepreneurship, expanding remote work, increasing outsourcing resources for workers, that's place-based and remote, and more urban to rural migration. And if you need a refresher on that question, it's in the chat too. So anyone want to tackle that one? It's a great question.
Hi, this is Aaron White with Eau Claire again. It's really at the forefront of some of our thinking right now, particularly showing that remote working and being able to work for a major employer, a national employer, and not having to be at that headquarters is a big piece. We're already seeing a little bit of spillover with folks who are transitioning from the Twin Cities to the community, to this community. We're within 90 miles of the Twin Cities. They can work remotely in a smaller community. What we're hearing from some of these folks who are making the transition is they feel safer in a smaller community than they do in the major metros. So we are an attractive distance from a Twin Cities type business, and we're looking to see how we can capitalize on that. Some of our down the road marketing and programming will be geared towards attracting more remote workers who can live in the community and enjoy the amenities of Eau Claire while still working for their employer, and whether it's the Twin Cities or Chicago or wherever. We're gonna build on that as much as we can, and we're seeing a lot of development occurring that will help support that. New multifamily housing options, lots of new housing options in general. So our marketing efforts will back that up.
I would just add that ability to work remote is going to help us with our workforce issues that Jen brought up as well. We have a local insurance company that has chosen to sell their office building and to go remote with all of their employees. And one of the reasons they did that was because of workforce issues, being able to get that skilled labor force. They're now able to hire not just from the area, but all over. But one issue that they didn't necessarily anticipate out of that is now that they're hiring all over the United States, they needed to raise their wages, because when you hire somebody in Appleton, Wisconsin, it's not the same wage base as Ithaca, New York. Our cost of living is different.
I would just emphasize, I think the location and the ability to access broadband is, the real Achilles heel of some of this growth, because, that's required for people to be able to work remotely and to do Zoom. Every rural area is really competing against each other for getting those resources if it's coming from the larger, internet providers.
Few other questions from the registrants that we may want to just answer. Are there different strategies for downtown revitalization? Is the Main Street approach the way to go, or is there other derivatives of that that might make sense for different kinds of communities? Creative ideas for community engagement in the downtown. What can make people interested in helping and saving their downtown area?
I This is Aaron White with Eau Claire. And I think one of the key things we're focusing on is just flexibility of thinking and how things develop in the downtown area. That's one of the reasons that drove us away from the RFP process for new development and looking at trying to fit overall development themes. The market is changing, demand is changing, the way they're doing business is changing. One of the projects that originally submitted an RFP for an open space, and everybody loved the idea, was 137,000 square feet of office space in our downtown area. That project ultimately did not go through because they found at the time that although this was their idea and they loved the idea and the community really backed it, there really wasn't a demand for it. And you know, now that we're sitting in an environment post-COVID that demand for office space in downtown area is even less than it was before, keeping flexible and reflecting on what, keeping in mind that the developers still have to be able to be successful in what they do. So be willing to look at, okay, do we really want to require a certain amount of commercial business on a ground floor, or are we willing to flex on what we've traditionally wanted to see in that downtown area to make sure that the development as a whole is going to be successful? That flexibility of thinking while working with the developers while still meeting some general goals in the community are going to be very important. And that's something that we're really stressing to do. So, you know, some of the developments may not be what you'd traditionally see in a downtown area, but if they meet our overall goals and can provide success, I think that's, you know, the types of projects we want to go after.
Let's take that question to La Crosse. La Crosse has a large store downtown. I think it's the Duluth Trading Company store, which is an unusual tenant for a downtown, but it's probably a very useful tenant to have located there. Is that something that's hopefully going to be expanded into the future into more cities? Or is that something just a test market in La Crosse?
I think they've tried it in a couple of communities. And as far as I know, they're happy with what's happening at their store in La Crosse. So hopefully it'll be something that they'll continue to expand on. Okay. So someone saying, yeah, Melissa saying that they have one in Red Wing downtown as well.
Okay, well, how about turning over the mics to those that want to share their projections for the future, assuming that we're going to be slowly moving out of the pandemic in the coming year, 2 years. What can we expect in terms of our downtown business mix, kind of people that will want to be downtown? Is it a positive or negative to have a downtown when you have a pandemic or another major crisis? How is it going to change? I asked one person in a consultant out of New York State who said that we looked at Ithaca and he said, well, Ithaca is going to be growing with the residential downtown in dining like it always has been for some years, but it's going to stop at retail. It's not going to be able to penetrate retail, whereas it can capture more entertainment dollars and, you know, food away from home dollars, but the retail is going to be the real stickler for many cities.
Now, one thing that we have seen in the past probably 3 years, and this was pre-COVID, but it wasn't that much before COVID, was some of the retail was shifting, not just, I mean, we still have the retail, but it was activities. It was escape rooms. We have an axe throwing and like arcade that is opened. And it's storefronts that are creating things to do, not just shopping. And I don't know, you know, how those have fared, particularly in this last year, but they're still open. And, you know, I wonder if that isn't part of that new mix that our downtowns, if they don't have them, should have them, is just those things that bring people to do something in the downtown, not just eating, drinking, and shopping. Mm-hmm.
I would echo Carl's comments. We saw escape room businesses start up prior to COVID here in Eau Claire, axe throwing and franchises built off of that are coming in. And you know, everything points to the younger generations wanting experiential type of events and venues. They're not they're not my generation, which just want to go out and spend their paycheck or part of their paycheck and then go home. They want to experience something unique, something different, something that they can capture in a really cool snapshot and throw it on Snapchat and throw it on their social media pages and share it with the world. And those types of businesses, we're actively looking to help support them. One of the things we do is through some software that we have, we help define the demographics of the community down to the block level in some cases, being able to provide median home incomes, trends in retail, market gaps. We can identify a lot of that through the software that we have access to, and we share that with prospective businesses. They help build their business plan and seek out financing. I think we'll continue to see a lot of interest in as well.
We definitely have an interest in experienced businesses as well. We've got the whole paint and sip concept and make your own barn sign and all of those businesses still active in the district for a number of years. The axe throwing business is a little out of my district. I'm a little bummed about that. I really want to try that out. But also other ways of engaging with the river here has become more and more prevalent. And really the fact that we have the walking trails and that connectivity and people wanting to move around the district can really impact the attraction for a new business coming into the district as well. Just found out about a new retail store yesterday. Very excited. Things are picking back up.
Wow, good. Anyone else?
One other thing I think that we're trying to do as a community is additional things, even if it's not downtown. The city put about 5 miles of trails, walking, hiking, and mountain bike trails with a partnership with an organization that builds these. And I think it's been an amenity that, you know, brings people in. They can mountain bike. They're within a mile of or two of downtown. And yet when they come here, they might be coming here to mountain bike, but then they also will stay at the hotels and visit the restaurants and whatnot. So, you know, having that smorgasbord of activities, not just downtown, but seeing that bigger picture of, as long as it's something that brings people into the destination of the area of the city, it's a win. And I think that that's, you know, one of those that sometimes maybe if we're focused just on downtown, we might forget a little bit about, but I think it's equally important.
Yeah, we find that most communities will depend upon a good 10 to 15% of the market to be coming from the visitor, the leisure traveler and business traveler too.
This is Aaron White with Eau Claire again. I noticed in the chat there was a question in regards to housing and affordability and affordable housing in our projects that we're looking to do on, and if we're requiring any components of that. We're really letting, to some extent, we're letting the market dictate. Not every, you know, we've come to the conclusion that not every location is suitable for an affordable housing project. And when we talk about affordable housing in our community, we're really talking about LIHTC type housing. Housing suitable for folks making 80% or less of the median county income. Our project that's doing second phase within the Cannery District, that second phase is a LIHTC project. We just got approval for a new LIHTC project in another part that's just outside of our downtown region. The award was announced just 2 days ago, so we'll have another LIHTC project coming in. A lot of the downtown housing is really focused on probably what we define as workforce housing, which is housing suitable for folks making between 80 and 120% of the median county income. So that's the folks that are mid-level supervisors, it's your teachers, it's your police officers, firemen, those types of positions. Getting the really affordable housing is really getting challenging without a heavy assistance from the city, which the city of Eau Claire doesn't have a big pool of funds to help with on the housing side of things. And with rising construction costs, that challenge is becoming even greater. But we did do a housing assessment, and we had a housing task force in the community looked at housing, and we have identified that there are gaps in our housing market across the spectrum of incomes. So this is one area where I say trickle-down effect, or trickle-up effect actually does work in a community. Filling some of those mid-price housing point gaps allows folks to move up in housing, which then frees starter homes for folks who are looking to find a true entry-level house. So addressing a variety of pricing levels and developments within the community does help the overall housing picture. It takes a little time, but it does work. And again, helping let the market drive it to some extent also helps as well.
Interesting.